nice to be here with you. Just let me first start by thanking ARNIKA for inviting me today. I had the pleasure to meet three of the people of the organization in June. They came to Iceland for a visit and we had a seminar in Reykjavik. And I must say that I learned a lot from that seminar, from the talks that they gave. And it's fair and easy for me to say that I got very good ideas on how to build on certain things that we are doing at our organization. So I was very happy with that. Very happy to be here today. So, yes, please. Well, I'm going to tell you a little bit about our organization, then go into public participation. Can you all see? I sort of feel like I'm standing in the middle of the screen. Sorry. Is that better? Like this?
Yeah.
So, go a little bit through the legal framework of public participation, the tools that we use at home, give you some examples that involve the public, and then at the end, discuss some obstacles and opportunities that I see in this. Okay. So, we've been around since 1969. We're founded mostly around soil conservation issues, but can you put the next one in? Since 2005 or so, we opened up for individual membership. Before that, we were like an umbrella organization. And we have been putting a lot of efforts into increasing the number of people that are behind our organization. And now that 4,500 people is not very many, but remember that we are only 330,000 apparently Icelanders in total. So the increase has been considerable in the last 2 years, and we are emphasizing this so that we can present it as a bigger organization. Here you can see the 10-member board that we have, and staff and on the next slide, staff and interns that were with us this year. It's mostly interns, we are not that many at the organization. So you put the next two in as well. So we focus on three main things, the conventional nature conservation, protecting different areas in particular, on environmental education. We are presented in about half of all schools in Iceland with an international program called the Eco Schools, which is part of the Foundation of Environmental Education, which is an international organization concentrating on education. And then environmental management, where we work with municipalities and a little bit with companies in trying sort of to green them. The nature conservation is what we are mostly known for at home, and centers around usually protecting certain areas. And our main conservation goal today now is the protection of the Central Highlands. Okay, the next one, please. So, as we go about what we do in these focus areas, we try as much as we can to involve people from the grassroots and elsewhere in our work. And I guess that in the environmental education, that is probably where we are at the strongest doing that, working with kids. You know, they, especially at a certain age, they are just great. So enthusiastic. Want to save the world. But it also is increasingly in the other areas. And next please. So we use three main methods. We participate in environmental decision making. We try to get the message across through the media and various other ways. And then we run a number of action and educationally based projects that I'm not going to go into. So the next one please. I'm going to concentrate on number one, public participation. Okay? And the next one, please. So like in many European and Central Asian countries, well, at least as in the European Union and the European Economic Area that Iceland is part of, much of our environmental legislation is built on the common European environmental legislation. And it is so as well in Iceland. So we have adopted the the law bills that secure access to information, participation in environmental decision making, and access to justice in accordance to the Aarhus Convention. Okay? So that is sort of the legal framework that we're working through. Now, I've put together, and you can just continue putting the slides on all the way to the, down to the end. These are some of the tools that I believe, or I have identified in our work, in what we do. So we write a lot of reviews on law bills, on municipality planning, environmental impact assessments, and such. And increasingly, we are using appeals of public decisions to try to get our message across. And that is using the access to justice pillar of the Aarhus Convention, obviously, which only was ratified in Iceland in 2011, many years behind most of the European countries and Central Asian countries. And we try as much as we can to assist other NGOs and obviously individuals. And it's especially here that I got so much material power from ARNIKA on the way that they do this. They run a center for citizen support. I was like, oh my God, I need to do that in Iceland. That's what they're going to do next. And I've started working on that, so thanks. And then there are all kinds of different methods. We are using petitions more and more to try to involve the public. But obviously the public is involved to a different degree using those different tools. So the next one, please. What I'm also very interested in is this difference between reactive and proactive environmental work. Reactive being reacting to something that the government or companies put forward. Being proactive, on the other hand, is to try to sort of, well, then you're more in control of things. You can present your work in a more proactive, positive way. And I've put these different tools here on a possibly increasing proactive approach. Sort of axis. This may not be correct, but there is some truth to it. So I think that lobbying and petitions and participating on especially governmental committees is at the more proactive end. The next one, please. If we look at the literature, some of the literature, at least the European literature, tells us that there has been too much focus on the processes and procedures, that is how we do public participation, instead of what is the purpose and outcome of these procedures. And I absolutely agree with this, because this is exactly how I feel about the public participation at home. Yeah, we have all the rights, basically, or most of the rights, but we do not necessarily have the capacity to use these rights. We lack money, we lack people, etc., etc. And this is an important distinction between rights and capacity. Please, the next one. And the next one. So I'm going to give you a few examples. So we review a number of legislative bills, planning drafts, and development projects. This is what we've been doing now for the last half year. In this work, it's often quite expert-driven. We do not have a lawyer at our firm, at our organization. We're working on that one. But we have volunteers. We have two really, really good lawyers who work a lot with us on these things. We also have other experts that are either members or come from the academia that would work specifically help us on issues such as ecology or geology or whatever it would be that pollution or whatever it would be that we would be working on. So the next one, please. And secondly, oh yeah, so this is, I put here down the sort of the tools that we use on these, when we are working on these reviews. So the next one, please. This is all in Icelandic. This is for you to practice your Icelandic. I'm sure you're very interested in that. But here we, I'm basically showing that, well, especially here in 2015, we've been increasing the number of appeals of public decisions that we have taken either to the courts or as we have right to, according to the Orders Convention and its ratification in Iceland, to a specific ruling committee that then rules on whether our whether that particular decision was correct or not. And in this work, the public is not really involved at all. This is very law-based, and that's our two volunteers that help us a lot on that one. Okay, so the next one, please. I started with Landvernd 4 years ago, and at that time, the chair of the organization also just started, fairly young fellow, and we were both very interested in how we can engage the people more. We had a change in government in 2013, to the worse in our opinion. I see I'm being recorded here, so there we go. But people were sort of really, really afraid of what would happen because there was a serious lack of emphasis on environmental issues with that new government. So we decided how can we use all this power to do something for the environment. So we decided to put up a small flag factory, green flag factory. So over the course of 2 days, we put together some 1,000 flags with a number of volunteers. And we thought, okay, we will get 500 at least. And then just each and everyone will hold 2 flags. But we will have 1,000 flags, you know. And that was sort of the symbol we wanted to make. We got some 5,000 people coming, marching downtown. Remember, out of 330,000, so it's not that bad. And it was a sort of a revolution to us. But then again, we're making a canal for people to participate. And you can feel the power and the need of people to do something. And that's important to harness that. The next one, please. Then we have increasingly been doing online petitions. So making or creating canals for people to participate in the sort of public participation that we are allowed to take part in according to law, okay? So one of the things that we did here, up in the north in Iceland is a lake called Lake Miva, which is on, it's a Ramsar site, protected as a very valuable wetland with a very rich bird life. And there is a small geothermal power plant there, not really to worry about, but there are plans of enlarging it a lot. So in 2012, the National Energy Company started preparing that enlargement. And we drew the attention of the media. We sent a complaint to the Ramsar Convention. So basically using our way of reviewing things a delegation from the Ramsar Secretariat came to Iceland. We had some 8,000 people signing this petition. And it basically, at the beginning, the National Energy Company was very reluctant to withdraw any of their plans. But after having that many people signing that petition, getting it on the media, sort of in a rather powerful way, they actually said, okay, we're willing to at least have the environmental impact assessment redone, because it was almost 10 years old. So that's where it basically stands now. The planning agency responsible for environmental impact assessments ruled on or made a decision that it should be redone. So that's where it stands now. So in this case, public pressure really did do a difference. So the next one, please. Or the next one. So very recently, only in November, we put up a petition that we ran for 6 days and got some 3,500 signatures. And that was on rejecting a plan for an environmental impact assessment on a high voltage overhead power line through the Icelandic Highlands, which is the told you in the beginning, our main goal is to protect that area. And this would really, really ruin it. So we're very happy about this one. And then the next one, please. Something similar, the next one, and three more. Something similar was you did in February, where the majority of the Parliamentarian Committee on Industries suggested to take a few ideas or potential power plants up in the highlands and put them into utilization so that to give a consent or give a yes to harnessing energy in there. And we also got some 2,000 or 3,000 signatures there. So perhaps these petitions are one of the most powerful ways that we really have to actively engage people. And it's using the internet, obviously. So this is one of the things that we have been concentrating a lot on. And what we do then next, after we've, you know, we have like these 8,000 or 3,000 or whatever signatures, we call people. We call every single one of them, or those that pick up the phone. We thank them for participating. We tell them what was the results. For example, with the Lake Miva petition, we could tell them, hey, this has all been halted, at least for the moment. The environmental impact assessment is being redone. And then we add, would you like to become a member of our organization? And we have had remarkable returns on that. So it's a really, really good model that I really recommend. So the next one, please. We also participate on committees, especially related to all committees of the government. So for example, I'm now on two committees on new legislation on soil conservation and forestry. And this is a much more proactive way of participating. And it's mostly our staff that work on this, but we are in good contact with certain members that are experts on the issue. So this is really something that we emphasize. And the next one, please. And then we do some extra legal expertise work using our really good volunteers. For example, we did an alternative report to Iceland's first periodic report on the Waters Convention a year ago. So we've been emphasizing that. And then the next one, please. So overall, we use basically all these methods to a different degree. And I just want to emphasize that social media is probably one of our best friends. It really helps getting the message across, you know, Facebook and Twitter, Instagram, etc. The next one, please. So the lessons that we have really learned is that at least these methods that we've been using, the parrots, petitions, etc. It really shows us that people are eager to participate. In my opinion, public participation can be quite tricky because often the processes are quite complicated. So you have to try to find simple ways to involve people. You know, not everybody is entitled or willing to read through 50 to 250 pages of a environmental impact assessment, plus all the expert reports related to it. It's just not like that. You have to simplify things. I also think that the role of NGOs is to engage people, and we have the role of assisting them. So we have seen some promising signs of increased interest of people, and you can just put the next slide in. For example, if you look at the participating schools in our eco-school project, it has been going up a lot since we began. And the next one. Number of members of our organization, and the next one. The number of times we've been seen on the media has been growing, and the number of likes on Facebook. So we're also trying to measure in one way or another if our approaches are working. And well, we're optimistic that they're doing in one way or another. Yes, please. The next one. So, and the next one. So how can we then, to conclude with, increase the influence by civil society or by NGOs? So I put forward three questions. What is needed? What do we really need to do that? What are the main obstacles? And how can we improve involvement? And you can put the next one in. And just put, I think, three or four more. So and just, I think there are a few. So the main obstacle is this lack of capacity. Lack of money, lack of expertise. Lack of meaningful ways to engage the public and this culture of power. And these are the things that I think we really need to work on. And the last one, so how can we improve civil society involvement and influence? And you can just put all of them in. In the Aarhus Convention, early participation is emphasized in environmental decision making. And this is something that we do not see very much often. We usually come to the table, for example, with development projects after they have been not fully designed, but in the process of being designed. Too late, in my opinion. And this goes generally. And simply governments and private entities, they could do many more things to try to increase this participation early on, and so can we. So if you just have the next one. This is all what I wanted to say. I just want to end this by showing you a few photos. Just before you do that, our main conservation campaign now surrounds the central highlands of Iceland where nobody lives. One of the largest last remaining wilderness in Europe. So if you give me the next one, and two more, yeah, this one. We have a campaign on a national park in the Central Highlands. And this is what we are basically dealing with. A number of potential power plants, power lines, and basically highways through the highlands. So this is our vision, this is vision of some other people. We have some promising polls showing that about 60% of the nation is supporting this idea. And only 12% is against it, that is, against the national park, which is something that is fueling us in doing good things. So if you just put the next slide on and leave it there, then you can enjoy the picture, because I think I was supposed to answer questions if I haven't probably gone far beyond my time, like in short. Sorry about that.
So there's space for the questions.
You have been talking about the 3,000 signatures on the petition. How powerful is this comparing to Czech Republic when ARNIKA have some 10,000 signatures? We are saying to us, okay, you are really good.
Yeah.
What about these 3,000? Is it powerful, or is there a possibility to get more or something like this?
Right. Like the last one we did, where we got some 3,500, which, and all, every single signature went to the planning agency. So they got an email separately from everyone. I believe it is powerful. It is, I mean, 3,000 out of 300,000. No, you can calculate how much that is. I don't know how many people there are.
When we have 1% of inhabitants, it's great.
Yeah.
Iceland's 10%, so it's great.
Yeah, 1%. I mean, I would love to go up to 10,000 usually when we're doing this, but it all depends on how widely you get the message across. So what we usually do is that when we put it up, we put it on Facebook, like, you know, I spam all my friends for like 2 or 3 hours, ask them to sign the petition, because what you really need to do is to get it, you also need people to like it, you know, that everybody else is doing, so it's always at the top of the newsfeed. Facebook usually finds out quite quickly, so the algorithm tries to put it down so that we boost it and pay them money for doing this, and we do that as well. But I think it's at least the planning agency was quite impressed how many signatures they got. And not only signatures, they did not put it out this way. They said, okay, we got in total some 3,000 blah, blah, blah comments on that draft. Instead of saying we got 30 and then 3,000 signatures, you know. Yeah. So they really said we got 3,000 comments.
So that means any comment was unique somehow, because people had possibility to write some...
No, they did not. It was identical, but it had some content. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's obvious that when we raise the question of public participation in decision making, the issue of cooperation and communication with public authority automatically appears.
Yeah.
So my question is, how public authorities treat your organization, how strong your voice is before them. Are they serious about you?
I think so. What I'm told is that they are. They would never tell me. I think that's for sure. Well, they may do it like, you know, you go to conferences, etc., and sometimes they take you aside and say, "So really good that you did that, but you also need to do that." And that might be a governmental official who is like, telling you sort of a secret. But yeah, I do think so. We've been, especially for the last 3 years, really active in writing very careful reviews, like backed up with literature and backed up with everything that we can back it up. So I know that it's looked at, and I know, for example, with the planning agency that they sometimes need someone to say things that they cannot say. So that when they make the decision, they can say, "Oh, we had some comments from the public or from Landvernd, as an NGO, which said this and this and this." And that's how they can sometimes use that as an argument for what they do. They don't do it always, but sometimes they can use it that way. And I've seen that being done, in public decisions. So yes, I think we matter, but how strong the influence is, I'm not sure. And that's exactly one of the slides that I had from the literature, saying that there is too much emphasis on the procedures and processes, and too little emphasis on the actual outcome effectiveness. And that is what we really, really need to look into academically. We need basically studies on this, at least at home. I'm not sure how it is elsewhere.
More questions?
I spent 3 weeks in Iceland, and most of the time I spent at Skaftafell Park. Mm-hmm. I think I went to the wrong place after seeing your picture. But my question, in the United States, one of the arguments against development of power plants and that sort of thing is the jobs issue. Do you run into that? I mean, people say, we need jobs, we need people to work. Is that
I can give you one good example. About 10, 15 years ago, there was a huge debate about a large power plant up in the east that was intended to fuel Alcoa aluminium plant down in the east fjords of Iceland. And obviously the main argument was we need to save this part of the country, people are moving away, yada yada yada. Most of the people who work there then come from abroad actually. It's imported workforce. I'm nothing against imported workforce obviously, but it's just, are you creating jobs for the people who live there or for someone else? But anyways, so that was one of the arguments. So both like the construction of the plants, but then also for whatever it's used. So that's an argument that's used all the time. Now today, when we are campaigning for a national park like this one, which will exclude a lot of energy options, we are in much, much stronger position than we were 10, 15 years ago. And there are two main reasons. We are using a proactive approach. We are actually presenting something positive, we are saying, let's make a national park there, which is full of opportunities for people, for all the rural and local areas surrounding the park, as opposed to other ideas. So we are not just being reactive and saying, no, this cannot be done. So we're proactive. And secondly, it's tourism. If I would show you figures of the increase in number of tourists in Iceland, I'm gonna draw it just here for you. I'm not gonna use a pen. So if you have like this Y and X axis, and you have year 2000 here and year 2015 over here, we had some 300,000 people in 2000. We're up to 1.3 million today. And in the last 5 years, we've had an increase by 20% between years. It's far too much. I'm deadly scared of it because of nature. But it's a very strong argument to use for nature protection, because over 80% of our visitors that come to Iceland, they mention nature as the main reason for coming. So I'm quite optimistic about that national park in the Highlands. We will lose a few battles, but I think we will win the war, to put it that way. But then I'm born optimistic, so. Right.